Well, welcome back to the podcast, Conversations with Jeff Bucknam. Dr. Jeff Bucknam is the lead pastor of teaching and vision at Harvest Bible Chapel in Chicagoland. I'm your host, Tommy Creutz.
Do you ever get offended that your name's not part of the title?
Yeah, I feel like, yes. Thank you for asking that.
Well,
that was really kind of
somebody asked me the other day if I enjoy being on Tommy's podcast. And I said, yeah, I actually really like it.
Yeah, his name's right there. It's crazy.
And I thought, wow, that's awkward for you.
Yeah, it is, you know.
It's like you doing all the writing for the book, but me having the name, you know. It's not even with Tommy. It's
just, well, to be fair.
In bold, Jeff Bucknam with a picture of me on the front, and then on the inside cover, like a little acknowledgement. Yeah. I want to thank Tommy Creutz for showing up every once in a while.
For just faithfulness. Yeah, no, I feel like I don't really do the like main meat of the conversation. You know, I'm just here in the beginning just to make sure that one, you know, people know, hey, what are they tuned into? Really important. And, you know, the other thing is bring people like education. It's a big part of it, right? We just got to tell people about what's going on in the world.
Yeah.
All the crazy things that are happening.
Yeah.
Share our opinions about stuff, you know? So, I don't know.
There's a curtain behind you now in our studio.
Oh, yeah.
They put a curtain in behind
Why?
You. And one of our guests is sitting behind the curtain and he's...
At any moment, he's just going to pop out and scare us.
He's telling secrets to his wife. It's all right. It's okay. I tell secrets about him when he's not around.
Yeah, is that right? You guys are going to talk about that today. It's going to be a conversation.
Why
about
is there a
secrets? Keep it secret.
There is a curtain though behind you.
Yeah. Why? And new set design. Yeah. Thumbs
so
up.
So the curtain is. I feel like the wizard's back there now.
How does it make you feel?
Well, I feel like uneasy? There's a whole part of the studio where things are happening, and I don't actually know what's going on. I don't know if I like it.
Wow. Yeah, I didn't notice that until you said it, and now it's behind me, so I'm not even looking at it.
There are currently five other people in the room, so I feel like we're getting to the point where you have a studio audience.
Oh.
I think we should actually add a laugh track.
So, also, another iteration of this is like, so when do we do conversations with Jeff Bucknam live?
From the Hollywood Bowl.
From, you know, yeah.
Live from...
In front of the audience.
No, we should... we should do that. I don't need to preach every week. I should just do one of the podcasts.
Yeah, we could talk about spiritual things on the podcast. It's okay.
Tommy, what are we bantering about today?
Yeah, well, for those who are new, who may be just tuning into the podcast for the first time, this is the part of the podcast, where we talk about whatever we want. It's called the Preamble Ramble or the Pre-Ramble. And we go through various topics. Last week was AI, you know, the dangers of that. This week, I feel like we are right at the end of...
I watched Rogue One last night.
Okay.
Okay, so Rogue One is the Star Wars movie.
Yes.
That...
You're speaking my language right now.
Yeah, I know I am. But there are a couple AI characters in it, or whatever you want to call them, like deepfakes.
Robots?
What are they?
What
well,
do you
they're
mean?
Not. They're
Who
like
are you talking about?
CGI characters one of the guys was dead when they made the movie.
Yeah.
And then they made him. So this, it was produced in, I don't know, 2016 or something.
Grand Moff Tarkin was not a real person.
Yeah. And okay, at the time I didn't know that.
Yeah.
But now it looks a little rough.
Yeah, the uncanny valley.
So I am, I'm telling you that our ability now in 2024 to make a character like a CGI character look legit is so much better.
Yeah, it's wild.
Than it was just 8 years ago.
Yeah,
that I'm getting a little frightened.
Yeah.
Again, by the fact that there are going to be
robot overlords.
Well, again. I think I brought this up last week when it comes to the church.
Oh, AI pastors.
I think that there'll be an AI pastor. And if you can make the AI pastor draw from, you know, because you can determine the source, the other pastoral sources that AI pastor. So what if, Tommy?
What if?
We had like 20 of the best pastors that we thought, you know, you and I,
totally,
and we said that we're going to program our little AI thing to draw sermons,
only those
yeah. things. Wouldn't that AI pastor be good, meaning doctrinally and stuff yeah. like that? Because those people would have a doctrinal, you know, care.
Yeah.
And wouldn't some people make the argument that it would be better than actually having a real pastor? Because a lot of real preaching pastors are just speak public speakers. I feel that way sometimes because I have to go to a bunch of different campuses and stuff like that. And they're just public speakers.
Yeah.
And so this person ends up becoming someone, they're not actually real. They don't actually have a real personality. They're going to speak good doctrine. They're going to actually be a good communicator, but they're not real.
Yeah.
But the benefit of them not being real is they're not going to fall. There's not going to be any like moral failing.
Yeah. Unless the
they're just an amalgamation.
The machine learning goes catastrophically wrong.
They're just
wrong.
An amalgamation of this character.
Yeah, it's interesting.
So, do you think people would attend a church where that was the case?
Yes,
you do.
I'm not gonna say what the follow up in my mind was to that exchange, but think of the yes, of course. Think of the churches that people attend now.
Well, think about our church.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
we do video and stuff like that.
Well, sure, but like, even
but I think the day of video is over.
The day of real.
No, I mean,
well, we talked about this last week too. Is like the idea of like the insane push toward AI, artificial intelligence, the audio, you know, and the video replication of that is. You said like it's going to bring us back to wanting more personal, see if everything's real.
I think so, but I think that there are going to still be people who are going to be like, "Nah, I'm cool with. I don't even know the pastor anyway."
Well, so there are people.
I'm cool with.
Yeah,
I'm cool totally. With my AI thing.
Yeah,
but then my question is, if you once you get to the point where you're cool with the AI thing, I just don't understand why you wouldn't go to church.
Yeah,
which is what's happening. I think COVID did that.
Yeah.
To us. Well, we just got all sick and tired of
the metaverse. What was it called? There was a church. There was a church.
There
in the
was not.
There was a church in the metaverse. Yeah, and you could like take your little avatar, and go sit in the auditorium.
Dude,
and,
what is up with us in our church? And, I get it. We are always using new technology to try to help people. Edify them and stuff. That's that's why we broadcast people's voices over loudspeakers and stuff because it's easier to hear, and why we use cameras and podcast. Look, but like when you gather as a church, I get all that. But some of the quick adoption of stuff so church leaders feel like they're on some sort of quote unquote cutting edge.
Yeah.
Is a little goofy. Yeah. I remember watching a video where a pastor was preaching and they had decided to use Twitter as like a live feedback tool. So behind the guy on the screen, no kidding, he's preaching and there's a Twitter feed behind where people are making comments.
Wow. That's
this
bold.
Is the
that's
dumbest
bold.
Idea
that's bold.
Ever.
That's bold. They gotta be pretty confident.
Yeah, people were like making comments about his pants.
Yikes.
Yikes.
Oh no. That's
and
not
so half the people in the room were like reading the Twitter feed.
Yeah. Hashtag nice
him.
Pants guy.
Yeah. Yeah. It, or every time he'd say something, people would make jokes or post memes. Like, what in the world?
Yeah.
Oh, my word.
I would not be able to pay attention in that scenario. Would
no.
you?
Oh, no.
No.
I'd be, no, the whole I'd be time lost. I'd be. But that's my point, is that it's almost like, well, we're going to do it because it's cutting edge. Because, and then every once in a while you get somebody who decides, you know what, there should be no pastor in the church. We should all just have, years ago there was a guy who's... name I can't remember, but he made a church in Minneapolis where they all had couches that just all the couches pointed different directions, like a massive living room,
but
had little pods of couches with, tables and stuff like that and microphones that just hung from the ceiling. So the whole room was mic'd.
Oh.
So if somebody, the guy who is the pastor would sit on a stool kind of in the middle of the room, and preach, quote unquote, preach, but people could kind of interrupt because, they had the mics near there. That church doesn't exist anymore. Because of what?
Yeah. Shocking.
At that one point, were people thinking to themselves, now this is going to be the future?
Yeah, probably. Nah, you don't think they were thinking that? They for sure thought that. Yeah.
I think that they thought
so, it. So, yeah, it's the power of the second decision. Hey, what about this idea? Oh, let's try it. Hey, that's a bad idea. Let's never do that again. Let's do something
else. Okay, but do you think that in 20 years' time, we're going to all look back and think to ourselves, do you remember when we had all the preachers on TV, on video? I mean, Harvest, we do this. Uh-huh. Do you remember we had all the preachers on video? Like, just so you know, here at Harvest, we're trying to move away from that. We're going to, in the long term, we're going to have live preaching at all of our campuses, just so you know. But will we look back and be like, well, I wonder why we thought everybody, I wonder why we didn't see how that bred celebrity pastors. Because it does. Of course it does.
Of course.
No, you don't.
Okay. No, of course, yeah.
I sound like I'm an old fuddy.
Yeah, you're such a curmudgeon right now. Yeah, goodness. How long have we been doing this one? What do we got on time, huh? We got time for another topic? Little time? Okay, we'll do it quick. It's almost spooky season. Are you a little bit of a spooky guy?
Have you ever been into a Spirit Halloween store?
Yeah, of course.
I have not.
You've never been in one?
No, I think it's. I think it's weird. I feel like they're like those little. I feel like they're illegal or something because they always put the fake sign out front.
It's
true. And I feel like they're just squatting in that space. Yeah. Then if I go in there,
because it used to be a Kmart, but it closed down.
Yeah,
and now it's just a Spirit of Halloween.
But Spirit
once every year.
Yeah, for like a month.
For a couple weeks.
And it goes away again.
But they're just squatting.
Yeah.
What a genius business model.
Is that
you
what
don't
it
have
is?
To, you don't have yeah, to lease.
No overhead.
Just squat. Speaking of squatting, also, wow, we're just all over the place today.
Here in the States, though, you guys have. I'm sorry, we.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
like, still speaking from outside the States to some degree. Yeah. The full bore excitement over Halloween is something I'm not entirely sure I get.
Yeah.
My neighbor I have just down the street's got a 15-foot skeleton.
Skeleton. There. Yeah.
And that's not the only one I see on my way home.
Yeah.
Why does everybody have 15-foot skeleton?
You know, it's become more available.
In September.
Yeah. Yeah. They're like the people who are like, it's like how my wife is for Christmas. Some people are that for Halloween. As early as they possibly can, let's put up the decorations. Because
there's a guy on the one of the main streets that I drive mm-hmm. who just left. He actually just left his Halloween stuff up all year.
All year.
Like he had skeletons throughout the entire front.
It kind of works for Christmas.
But he would dress them all up into the different...
Yeah.
So the skeletons stayed, but he would just dress them up into the different times of the year. Like he had flags on them for 4th of July.
Sure,
and
sure. You do a little Nightmare Before Christmas
June,
thing.
All June, he had the gay flag on him.
Oh,
And Christmas, they had little hats on, Santa hats and stuff. Mm-hmm. I don't know, man.
Yeah.
That's, no.
You're not a spooky season guy?
No.
Do you watch scary movies? Do you like to be scared?
I like an alien or two.
Okay.
Again.
Okay.
The alien needs to die in the end, but I'm okay with the aliens.
They always have to die.
But no, I actually, the proliferation of the horror genre, I don't quite get.
Yeah.
I don't think it's I think it's weird.
Yeah.
Do you watch horror movies?
Yeah.
I do. Tommy, are you a pastor?
Yes.
Yes. Christian pastor.
Listen, you stop it with this satanic panic, all right? It has no power.
Where would you draw a line in terms of horror movies?
I don't do the gory, like, over, you know, like the super gory, gratuitous, like...
Like all of them?
No, not all of them are gratuitously gory. And nonsensical. I'll watch like people are usually like, oh, I stay away from like the spiritual ones. I'm like, I'm in. Like, know thy enemy. You know what I mean? Know thy enemy. Got to know their playbook. Listen, we're sitting in a room. Someone's head starts turning around. I know what to do.
Because you've seen that movie.
I'm not surprised.
Okay, so the only thing that I've seen that I think is pretty good, Stranger Things, pretty good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they've got some of that, like,
I'm okay with that
mystical, demonic.
I'm okay with that level of weirdness, but mm-hmm.
I think it goes to show you, like, there are some good principles, like paranormal activity is one. Again, I wouldn't recommend any scary movies, especially if you're a scaredy cat. But that one is like, they started like,
do you just like being freaked out? Is it the jump scares that you like?
I like the, like all the other things like that you watch, you know, like what is it? Like the Jasons and the aliens and things is like, that's that all in my mind, like fake. It's fake. Like, why would I be afraid of something that's not real? But like we know the spiritual realm is real.
So you like, so that you like those ones.
What's more real, right? Like the demonic exists. Oh, and so like it's, you know,
I don't know, Tommy.
And I'm just over there with, you know,
for those of you who ready are to do battle, in confronting, you know? Tommy on this on this disputable matter, would you please email him?
Yeah, email me at Jeff Bucknam. Conversations with Jeff Bucknam.org.
Speaking of scary.
Yeah, these transitions are always the best. We go from crazy things to an actual great conversation because we do believe that everyone has a story. And so we have a married couple with us today, and the Stotzes, and they are faithful members of our church and have been a part of so many different ministries that it would be impossible to name them all right now. But you guys are going to have a conversation, little two for one this week, which is going to be really fun. And we believe that they have a story and you guys are going to get into theirs right now. Let's go.
Sitting here with the Stotzes. Can you introduce yourselves?
Rob and Jen Stotz.
Rob and Jen Stotz and... Oh, sorry.
It's actually not Robin.
Right,
Jen and Rob. There we go.
There you go.
I know. And then I was like, I didn't know her name was Robin.
That's right.
It's Rob and Jen.
That's right.
Stotz. Got it.
That's good.
That's great. How old are you guys? It's the first thing you ask.
Right?
Be 54 in a couple, in a week, something like that.
Are you the same age?
Nope. I just turned 50.
Wow. So. He was robbing the old cradle there back in the day, huh? Mm-hmm. How old were you when you got married, Jeff?
20. We've been married 30 years.
Yeah. Congratulations. Thank you. Fantastic.
Yeah. We were babies.
Well, one of you was.
That's right.
True.
That's fantastic. I want to ask where you've met and all of that in just a second. First of all, what you guys have been attending Harvest Bible Chapel for a long time. Mm-hmm. How many years?
30.
Since 94.
Mm-hmm. Holy smokes.
Since we were in high school.
I think that might be one of the longest. I think we had somebody, I think, who was in like 1990 or so, which was like a year or two after that it had begun. But you guys came to Harvest quite early on. Why?
So I knew James because he was at Arlington Free.
Okay.
Where my parents were.
Yes.
And so he
Which
was
is now
teaching,
the Orchard.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Got
he
it.
Was teaching the singles ministry.
Okay.
And my sister had attended it once or twice. And so I was like, I was aware of him in that building and that thing. So when he started his thing, my first visit to see him was in 91, the week after the church split in half.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Nice.
I came in, I was like, why are all these chairs set up? There's only half people here. You know, it's like, this is a lot of waste. This is a lot of work for nothing, you know, because it's just a gymnasium.
Yeah.
So but it's pretty funny.
That is
But then they had
funny.
A thing afterwards and chatted around people.
Yeah.
Eventually put two and two together. I didn't really realize at the time, but.
Jen, were you attending the church at the time? Because you guys would have gotten married, right?
We got married right after we started attending here together. Like, he just came and visited. And then we were looking for a church. I had done a summer missions trip in Amsterdam, of all places, the summer before we got married. And it was the first time I had ever seen lively worship, like, because we grew up in a little more traditional churches.
Uh-huh.
And I came back, and I just knew that I wanted to worship that way.
Okay.
I couldn't worship with, you know, the old, more traditional stuff. And so we started church hunting because we were getting married, and that's what young people do, is they find their way. And we tried Harvest, and that was it. It stuck.
Never went away from Harvest to another place. You just came to Harvest. Boom.
We moved twice. We lived in, so when we first got married, we moved to Orlando for 9 months, moved back, moved to San Diego, then a year later for a year and a half, and moved back because God was gracious, and we never found churches in either of those places that were home.
Okay.
And so here we are.
Well, I want to know. I'm going to ask about Orlando and San Diego in just a minute. Are you guys from Chicago? Is this your home? Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So when I say Chicago, I mean Chicagoland. Or are you from Chicago?
No, Buffalo Grove and Arlington Heights.
Oh, okay. So right near each other. Yeah. So you kind of grew up within spitting distance a little bit of each other, but never knew each other.
Not really. Same youth group in the later years, but I was graduating when she was coming into the high school group. So
yeah,
I
she
knew,
was
only
like a,
knew of her because
she was like
I
a middle did. School when you...
Exactly. Yeah, that's what I say. Okay. We joke about that. Sure. Like I was going to junior college, but then trolling the eighth graders.
Got it. You know, nice. Yeah.
That's creepy.
It is creepy. That's why we joke about it. That's
yours. And I also have the disclaimer that I didn't meet him until after the mullet was gone.
Oh.
So yeah, he has a long history of exciting hair. Oh,
so how long did you have a mullet?
Till 91.
Oh, it's not that late.
It's not. Because the it late 80s, still, we were soccer players.
Had no, ponytails. Okay, mullet, but he had like the Andre Agassi version of the mullet.
Nice.
So.
Richard Marx.
Oh.
Also.
Nice.
True.
Also Chicago.
That is a that is a full-fledged mullet. I like it.
Mm-hmm. If you go swing by his art lab at HCA, he has pictures from high school on the outside of his door, and you can see him with the full-fledged
mullet. Kids get to see me in high school.
I will, for those of you who are around HCA. Now people are going to be wandering through the hallway going, there it is. There's the mullet.
That's the guy.
Jen, you're from, you're from Buffalo Grove, and Jen, you're from Arlington Heights. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Did you grew up in a kind of Christian family? You went to church there? Or?
Nope. I grew up in a family of, I guess my mom was Catholic growing up. My dad was Presbyterian growing up. But I didn't know anything about the Lord other than random Christmas stories and going to church with neighbors when they went. And then my mom, really, like her testimony is kind of woven in with mine. She... started asking the Lord to show himself to her. And the people that came by that answered the questions for her were the Jehovah's Witnesses. So she spent a while studying with them. My dad, in the meantime, knew enough to freak out and know that that wasn't what he wanted for his kids.
So wait, when you say she studied with them, she went to, went to church?
They came and studied with her a bunch, and then we started going to the Kingdom Hall.
Yeah, why are there no windows?
That is a fantastic question. I mean, honestly, like there's, can I say out loud? There's not like exciting stuff going on inside that you'd be afraid to.
No, I just don't. I've never understood the window thing. I've talked to Jehovah's Witnesses before, but
and
I've never asked
the
window
question. They all look exactly the same.
Yeah.
Every time. Oh, Kingdom Hall.
Yeah.
Yeah. Nope.
You don't know?
I have no idea.
All right.
I was in eighth grade, so, you know, I wasn't asking a ton of questions. But yeah, so we had started going there, and we had dropped the minor holidays of, we didn't do Halloween, spooky season. We weren't doing Halloween that year, and we weren't going to do Easter baskets at Easter, and she was ready to graduate to birthdays and Christmas the following year. And this whole time, she was just praying because it was causing such upheaval in our home, like, Lord, if this isn't you, you need to show me. And in the way that the Lord usually does, faithfully, a neighbor had been inviting her to a Bible study. She had always said no. One day she went last minute, and the last minute filling guest speaker, she and her husband had been editors of the Watchtower magazine. Mm. Wasn't even scheduled to speak that day. Somebody else had car trouble. She stepped in. And my mom made a beeline to her afterwards. The lady met with her for 2 weeks. And at the end of that, she gave her life to the Lord.
Wow.
And brought then us along to a tiny church, where I think there were maybe 50 people at the church, no youth group, nothing like that. So my first introduction to the gospel was helping out in kindergarten VBS that year. Mm-hmm. And so I heard it was a gift and all you have to do is unwrap it, you know, and it's for you and it's free. Now, why would anybody say no to that? That's dumb. You know, so that was the day I received the gift of salvation. But no one ever told me until much later when I was in a youth group, sophomore year of high school, that there was a life component to it.
Yeah.
So I did not, to answer your question, long answer to a short question.
Didn't grow up in a Christian home.
Did not grow up in a Christian home.
And it was sort of a two-stage thing where you were like, yeah, I'll have that gift. But it wasn't like, oh, yeah, by all the way, also repent.
Yes. Believe.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you more Christian home?
Yeah, I grew up in a Christian home for sure.
Yeah. Family, like brothers and sisters and stuff all?
I have two older sisters and a brother, younger brother. So, yeah, the two sisters came about 10 years prior to me, and then they couldn't have kids anymore, so they adopted me. And then, surprise, they could have kids 5 years later, my brother.
Okay, so you are like middle child but adopted child in the family.
Far enough after, you know, the first two that it was like we had two. They were raised separately, then they were off to high school and college.
Yeah.
And me and Randy were kind of on our own doing our thing.
Okay.
So it was an interesting... Also, but yeah, they were our believers the whole time, you know, that I was there. So I grew up in that environment, going to church and fairly normal, I would say. Yeah. Up through high school.
You said before we started here, you a bit of an athlete.
Yeah. Hit I like me. To play.
What do you like to play?
I play almost anything.
Cricket?
Yeah. Crickets for sure. No.
I've never witnessed that.
I haven't done that.
It's fun, actually.
That's right. I bet.
Yeah.
You know, your experience in New Zealand has paid off.
Yeah. Well, it's funny because I actually, where I used to live in Canada, there was a large Indian population and they played cricket every like Sunday. And I ride my bike to and from the church and community. And so I would stop and I'd just sit and watch. And these guys would be like, how do you know, like what an over is? And how do you know? You know, that it's called a wicket and what, you know, how do you know it's four and the six and stuff? And I got in conversations with them. They never let me play though. I was a little irritated by it because I was like, dude, I'm a pretty decent bowler. Bowler's like a pitcher and I'm a spin bowler. I can do it. I'm legit.
Nice.
And, but they were like, no, you can never do it. But
I think you're going to get some letters about that now.
It's helped me get to, if someone wants to let me play cricket, it is a lot of fun. It is. And people always think, it can last 5 days. And I'm like, yeah, it's pretty great. Okay, you're not a cricket player. What did you...
I played... So growing up, you know, in the 70s and 80s, we played all sports all the time. Always outside. And so we'd play anything. Now, eventually, I started with baseball for the first couple of years. To be honest, like, I just was like, I was good at it. All-star my first couple of years. And then, like, the heat turned up on the pitchers. You know, I got hit 1 year, and I was like, yeah, I think I'm good.
Oh,
like,
you and me too. I got hit in the...
I was like, and I was done.
Stop me in baseball.
Yep. Yeah.
I played a lot of other sports, but, like, as soon as someone hit me, it was in the back. And I was like, yeah, no, this is stupid. Why would I stand here while someone throws the ball at me?
As hard as they can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's nuts.
Yeah. So then I played soccer because that was viable, but grew up watching football with my dad, me and my brother. So we played a lot of that on street ball. You know, we'd go to the park because it was only a quarter mile away and all the kids would play.
He's a Bears fan.
I love playing that. Yeah, he was. So, but
back in the 80s too, where like being a Bears fan, you got it solidified there in 85. I mean, you had lots of years where, you know, you kind of had Bears fans kind of liked other teams, but then in 85, it was like, no, I'm Bears.
I'm a Dolphins fan and we beat them that year.
Since then, it's been not so great. So what do you mean we beat them there?
That's Miami.
What?
So I'm a Miami Dolphins fan.
Why?
My brother's a Cowboys fan. He let us pick when we were kids.
Why did you pick the Dolphins?
Because they had just won. It was like the late 70s, you know, the early 70s. Yes. And so I was like, I like their helmets because they're cool because they got a Dolphin.
They
so
did.
That's what I picked.
Yeah.
And then my brother, you know, he scorched us for years, man.
Well, in the 70s,
he had Aikman and, you know, Emmitt Smith, and they tore us up for a good decade there. We were not winning, but my brother Randy was celebrating.
Yeah.
He was having a good time.
Miami Dolphins have been basically irrelevant for...
We have been. Since then.
50 years.
Since then. I mean, I had Marino, but, you know, we could cheer, but we couldn't win anything.
Yeah, get to that. So. One championship. Yeah. Wasn't it his rookie year?
I think so.
Dan Marino's a rookie. He gets to the Super Bowl. He's probably thinking to himself, I'll be here a lot.
Yeah.
And then...
I know.
Next thing you know, he's losing to the Seahawks. Which is embarrassing to lose to the Seahawks in the 80s. Come on.
What
is wrong with you? They're terrible. I'm a Seahawks fan. They were awful.
It's all good.
That's good. But now you cheer for, you still cheer for the?
Nah, I'm still a Dolphins fan.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So not a good year for us, but it's fine.
Well, it's because your quarterback keeps poking his head into other people's chests. And
I talk about it.
It's not a bad, it's not a good way to play.
I didn't want to see him play last year. I didn't want to see him this year. But now I had to watch it. So now here we are.
Okay.
Quarterbackless and nothing to show for it.
Have you ever been to a Dolphins game?
I have. My dad took me when we were younger because he knew that was my thing. And so he took me to Indianapolis because they played the Colts. They were in that division for a long time. So I got to go down there a couple times. My brother went with me. So we had a blast. So that was a good time. And then now I see them when they usually beat the Bears.
Yeah.
So we come out here and we watch them then.
Okay. Well, that's good.
Exactly.
Jen, do you care?
No. Absolutely
no,
not.
No, seriously. Did you have any interest at all in sports or anything when you were growing up?
I played softball and volleyball, like the things that you know. In our house, we played we played softball or baseball.
Yeah.
And then us girls played volleyball when we got to high school. Okay. But sports aren't my thing.
What are your thing? What is
my thing?
Well, when you were younger, what was the thing that you were most interested in?
I was not a good kid, Jeff. I was like all emo and
sick. Nice.
Yeah. Oh yeah. No, my room, I painted it black and all the black and white and the thing. And
you painted your room black.
I did.
Again, this might be the second week in a row where I asked somebody this question.
Oh, no.
You were right into Depeche Mode.
Depeche Mode, oh, The Cure, God. Ministry, all of those, Nitzareb. But like, there were a bunch of bands that you shouldn't let your children listen to that I listened to quite a bit.
Okay. So. And it made you sad.
I think I was sad you're beforehand, like the embodiment and it was just enough.
You're the embodiment of Gen X right here.
Are we Gen X?
Yeah.
Is that what we are? Yeah. I can't even keep track anymore. Yeah. That was me, 1,000%.
Did you have really dark? Did you dye your hair black?
No, I was not allowed to do that, but I made up for it in clothing.
Okay, so. All black clothing. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. I'm just, wow. I would have been fun to have met you back in those days.
No, it wouldn't have. There's so many reasons why we never would have dated had we met in that stage.
Nice Christian boy.
Right, Christian boy the sports, with the mullet. And me.
Yeah.
No.
So where did you meet?
So our youth group and our savior.
No, we didn't meet at the youth group.
Well, okay.
Yeah.
I was going to get into who you dated, but sure.
Well, there you go. That was it. He dated a girl for 5 years and I dated a guy for 3 years and we double dated.
Wow. Mm-hmm. How often?
Whenever he was home from college. So summers. Yeah. Yeah.
Rob, at what point during these double dates did you look kitty corner and think to yourself?
I never did.
Okay.
No. Isn't that the crazy thing? Like we really didn't.
Okay.
And it's funny because I remember like all the younger, because he's older, right? You know, he's 4 years older than me.
Okay.
And so.
Let's keep hitting that.
Three and a half. It's fine. So all of the young youth group girls, like he had been a youth leader and all that stuff. So all the young youth group girls were like, oh, Rob Stotz. And I'm just like, oh, whatever. You know, like he was my boyfriend's friend. I never noticed him. I never thought he was cute and all this stuff. Until the Lord was like, that. And I was like, oh, he actually is kind of cute.
Oh.
So, yeah. We went out.
She's blinded.
Did she get new glasses or something? I know. Exactly. Yeah. She wasn't wearing the glasses?
Exactly.
Right,
that's
right. More like
it's just really late at night. Right. Whoa, I guess in the certain light.
Right. And then the scales fell from my eyes. Is what
in
it was.
Absolute darkness. It's not so bad. And the hair is, it's okay now.
No, that's the over 50 in us.
Well, what was happening? Did you break up with your old boyfriend? And then
I did. So he broke up with the girl he dated for a long time. And then we double dated with him and the next person he dated. And that didn't last very long. And then when I broke up with the guy that I had dated for 3 years, I thought, oh, you know who knows how to do this well and still stay friends and all this stuff? Rob Stotz, because they all still had the same friend group and he was still friends with the girl. And so I was like, Rob knows how to do this with class and he knows how to do it well. I'm going to call him and see if he wants to just go have coffee and explain to me how.
Tea.
That's right. Sorry. We had tea, which he does not drink, which should have been my first clue that he's wonderful. But he took me to tea. And
neither of you like tea.
I love tea. Okay. That was his. I was like, oh, there's this cute little like emo tea house in downtown Chicago. And we should go. And
all he's right,
like,
fine.
Okay. Yeah, that's exactly what it was. He's like, I have the car. I'll pick you up. So yeah, we went to tea and 3.5 hours later, still had never discussed any of that stuff. And 2 weeks later, he said, you know, if we're getting married, we should probably start dating first. And I said, yeah, it's probably a good idea.
Wow.
And that was 31 and a half years ago.
Yeah. That's quite a line, Rob.
I mean, you
come right out with it. Well, we've been on, although you could have been like, man, we've been on a lot of dates together. So like,
right. If I've seen all the moves, I've seen all the lines by that point. So I was either in or out, but yeah, he is wonderful.
And how long did you date then? A year and a half?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just about.
But you were pretty sure, Rob, that you
I think
were
because we were both talking about what we wanted in a spouse. Like we knew what we didn't, right? We had dating relationships that had kind of gone their natural way of like, okay, they're done. So like, what do you want out of your partner? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, so when we were, I think as we were describing it, we were like, we want the same things. Mm-hmm. And prioritizing the Lord amongst the top of it wasn't common. Mm-hmm. You could have people in the youth group you were dating, but their version and priority of where he was never the same. Yeah. And so like you'd get to these things and you're like, okay, I want somebody that cares as much about it as I do.
Yeah.
And that's what we were looking for. And so, you know, you have a conversation for hours and hours and hours and start talking about that over the phone. And you're like, I think we're talking to each other. You know what I mean? About the exact same thing. Mm-hmm. And so now she was going away. So it worked out well because she went to Amsterdam. That was an awesome experience for her. Mm-hmm. You know, pre you could do the calls. So it's like, long distance phone call.
Dad. You know, I had like to use my dad's business calling card to call him. And
did you go to, you both went to college, different places?
Mm-hmm.
Which one did you go to, Jen?
I went to 4 different schools.
All right, schools. Hit us with them.
For the first 2 years, I was at Trinity in Deerfield.
Okay.
And then we got married. So I stopped going to school.
Uh-huh.
And then 9 months later, we realized that starving artist is a real thing and I probably should finish my degree. So we came back here and I went to Harper to start adding credits. Then I went to DePaul for a year and then he got his dream internship with a comic book company in San Diego. So I finished at University of San Diego.
All right.
There you go.
USD. I love
Toreros.
It. Yeah. And Rob, where did you go to college?
I went to Harper High. Yeah, that's our junior college. So I had 2 years there. And then I went down to Ringling School of Art and Design in Sarasota.
Okay.
For a year and a half.
When did you decide that you didn't graduate from there, though?
Yeah.
What's your, like, if you show me your degree right now, where does it say?
I don't have any.
Nice.
Yeah.
I love it.
Artists. Then I went to Trinity for a semester.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Then I went to a couple.
He went to Trinity and roomed with the guy I was dating. So that was.
Yeah.
Yeah, we chatted a lot during that year. But
it's true.
Yeah.
When did you realize, Rob, that you wanted to do art? Like, were you always good at drawing?
Yeah, no. Like, well, I think, sure. Like, I think there were pieces that I could draw better than other kids, but that was all it was. And then I started reading a lot. My mom was an avid reader. And so, like, the downstairs was, like, built-in bookshelves with, like, a million things from Reader's Digest, you know, which was all...
Yep.
You know, 5 and short stories and whatnot. And so I became an avid reader probably in 6th grade from my 6th grade teacher who used to read aloud to us. And so when she did that, I was like all in. I was like, wow, this is amazing. These stories are great. And so I started reading. And I was consuming everything from, you know, Clancy to you name it, the typical Grisham, mm-hmm. right? Anything that was popular, Crichton, anything that was popular during those 80s times. Now, along with some appropriate stuff that was probably more like Hardy Boys, things like that, that it was written a little towards my age. And in 8th grade summer, a friend of mine that I had grown up with in my parents' Bible study had moved to Minnesota in 6th grade. And so like he sent me, he's like, I went to a comic book store and I bought these comics. And so I'm sending you some for your birthday. You know, so he sent me an envelope.
Yeah. Which comics?
It's like Power Pack, which is like a Canadian kids, you know, thing.
Yeah.
And there was like 2 others in there. I don't even remember what they were. But I was like, oh, okay, cool. You know, and my brother, who was 5 years younger, we were both looking at him. We were like, oh, this is neat. Maybe when we're at the bookstore, because I'm always there with my mom buying books, there's a little spinner rack, you know, that had like comics on them for like 50 cents or 65 cents, I think at the time, 60 cents. So we went over there and we just started picking them, you know, like, hey, well, let's get 3 to read. Like I can buy a book for $6, $5.99 paperback, and still get, you know, 2 comics. So I would do that. My brother would get other ones so we could share. And so that was a little unique because that became like, oh, people are drawing this?
Yeah.
Like every month? like a soap opera. Like, this is crazy. Like, the amount of work, but it's cool. Yeah. I like the story. So, like, oh, I'll try to draw on that, and I'll try to draw on that. And that's how my art started fostering. Yeah.
What's your
favorite? I love storytelling.
What's your favorite comic today? You must still have some around, no?
They do. I would say, well, I don't know if I should say. You know, Invincible is probably my favorite overall. Okay. It's over. It's done. It was like 144 issues.
Yeah.
And now it's on Prime.
Yeah.
So they're making that 10 years later, but it's all good.
Yeah.
But I really enjoyed the story. You know, it's dark in places.
Yeah.
It's Kirkman, you know, who wrote and created Walking Dead.
Yeah.
So he explores, like, you know, how do people react socially when I create this stressful environment?
Yeah.
You know, and with superheroes, it was the same.
Yeah.
But so there's some good in there and some bad, but I would say it's probably my favorite.
Well, my roommate in college was an avid comic book guy. Oh. I remember going with him to the comic book store.
Okay. I'm sorry.
And he, you know what though? It was the first time in my life I actually got, so we would sit in our room together in college.
Yeah.
And he had so many comics and that's when I started, you know, reading them, and he was an art, and, he actually ended up graduating and getting, he had a job at, I can't remember, but it was kind of in the early days of the electronic art type stuff. And he was designing stuff for video games and stuff. Mm-hmm. And it was the first time I realized, oh, this is actually a genuine art form.
Yeah.
And it's quite remarkable. And some of the artists are fantastic. And you're right. The storytelling is actually quite excellent. It's better than a lot of the comics on, or the cartoons on TV and stuff.
Yeah.
A little deeper and sometimes gets involved in.
I wish they weren't as dark, but as they are, but at the same time, they're great. They were a ton of fun.
Yeah.
You know, they were just really good and they were fun to be a part of.
And when we're talking comics, we're not talking like Dilbert. We're talking, you know what I mean?
Yeah, right.
We're talking about a little bit more
as good as that is.
Design and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So, Why are you in Amsterdam?
I did missions with YWAM.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I, like I said, coming from like the emo, like we didn't even call it emo back then. What did we call it? Alternative or whatever we called it.
Know.
You know, I don't know.
Grunge. I called it dumb, but go ahead. Go ahead.
New wave. I don't know what.
Bat cavers.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. That's good.
Nightwalkers. I don't know. But I, coming from that general, understanding, I guess, for lack of a better way to say it. I had a huge heart for the drug culture, the people that are just living
in Amsterdam. In that would have been it.
Amsterdam. So I did. I got to go and spend 3 months there.
Was it a good experience for you?
It's a phenomenal experience. It shaped, gosh, I can't think of a thing it didn't shape in my life. It was the first time I had seen, I'm a Midwest, you know, Northwest suburbs, Arlington Heights girl, you know, born and raised. And, you know, we went to state parks in Indiana on our vacations, you know, and things like that. So I had never been out of the country. Yeah. I don't even think at that point.
Sorry, I'm just thinking. Yeah. It's a little different than Amsterdam.
Yeah, yeah. So, and I went by myself. They literally put me on a plane and they said, here's the address.
Good luck.
See you in 3 months. Of course, my parents were probably freaking out, but
YWAM.
I was so.
YWAM's totally you'll figure it out.
And I didn't even know what YWAM was. I didn't know what Pentecostal was. I'd only been walking with the Lord for a couple of years, so I had no clue. So I went, and it was the first time that I had ever experienced worship like that.
Yeah.
But it's also the first time that I had ever seen anyone shoot up heroin in the walk down to a basement apartment. And I had to learn that, you know, you can't give the people more than 2 sugar cubes because they crave sugar, you know, when you're hosting the coffee bar. And we went into the red light district, and it was the first time nobody talked about what human trafficking was back then. But we were working with the girls from the Dominican, and these people's stories were just like, for the little Midwestern girl that I was, had no clue what was happening in the rest of the world. So I think that, I mean, again, like I said, there's nothing I can point to in my life that didn't have a part in shaping. It gave me a huge passion for ministry. It gave me a huge passion for people that were different than I was. It gave me, I wanted my kids to see that. That was one of the big things that he and I were like, oh, that's different. We both wanted to do short-term missions with our family one day. And you know, and here I was ready to go on a missions trip. And, you know,
yeah,
I don't know. It was phenomenal.
Have you done that with your kids?
We did actually with one of them, our oldest one. I took Emma to our church plant in Calgary, the Harvest Church plant there. And we did a VBS there.
Oh yeah.
And then John was coming the next summer. So yeah. That was kind of the end of mom taking the kids on the missions trips. Yeah. So, but then Emma and Ellie were slated to actually, our two daughters were slated to go together to the Dominican. And I believe it was it Dominican that they were? I don't know. Anyway, I think it was the Dominican. And literally they were supposed to fly out 2 days after everything shut down for COVID.
Oh, okay.
So, so that kind of shortened things a little bit. So we settled for local ministry stuff with the kids.
Yeah. Well, the year before, we took a group to Romania to do exactly that. So we took the Jacksons and their kids. We took the Houstons and their kids. So
yeah.
We took a bunch of families. We didn't take ours because we were leading the group at the time. So it was just like we went in there and we kind of prepped it. And then that's when they decided to change everything. We had kind of built a relationship, and then they decided to pair churches.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So this church will partner with that church in Romania, and this church will do that. Yeah. And we were like, oh, okay. So then Calgary. She went out on a little thing to Calgary. Yeah.
I want to ask you guys about your kids in just a second, but I'm still stuck on why you ended up going to Orlando and then San Diego. Hmm. Why?
Yeah. So,
and then you said for 9 months to Orlando.
Yeah.
She wouldn't have made that. She couldn't have survived the summer.
Yeah. There's hot. No way. Yeah, no, she was thanks. Like, mm-mm.
But, so we went down there. They had a lot in illustration. I was trying to do freelance at the time. And so down there, they had a lot of book publishers that did like academic books. So the school books always needed illustrators to like do, hey, I need an illustration of this. And I need an illustration of this for this book and this book and this book. And they're always doing revised versions because they like selling new versions every year. So there was plenty of work for us at the time. I didn't get any of that work, but like that's what we went down there, assuming that that was something that I could get. Even though I had more of a comic book style, that's what I wanted to do. And but what I did have down there was I had friends from Sarasota. That school, Ringling, was a feeder school for Disney.
Okay.
So it had a really great animation and figure drawing department. And so they had a lot of people that had worked in the animation field. So two of my friends that I worked with or met in college were there. One was trying to get into Disney, and one was already in doing an internship. So we went to Orlando so that I could work with them at the same thing. I'm trying to get into my industry. You're trying to get into yours, you know, and at the same time, there is this freelance market that we may be able to make some money into. Mm. And so that's what we were doing down in Orlando. It was a very short stint.
And what made you think to come back? Did you go down planning to be there for a long time?
I don't know if we wanted to be down there a long time. I don't think that was the goal. I think it was down there. I knew people. I needed to get better. They would help me get better.
Yeah.
But same thing. I mean, we bounced around from churches 3-4 weeks here, go over here, tried that one. We couldn't find one that was really feeding us.
Yeah.
So we kind of knew, and again, money too, like we weren't making it, like we weren't making money. And so it became like, look, we can't stay here, even though it's like $500 a month, you know, for a 2-bedroom, 2-bath, like we just can't survive. Years ago, yeah. Like she was working as like a secretary at a law firm. And so I was like, okay, it was great. I needed that time. James Finch, who works at Disney in Cali and is still a really close friend, he was singularly instrumental in sitting me down and being like, Rob, you stink. Here's how you need to get better. Like, you can do all this stuff, but you have no foundation. So if you fix the foundation, what you do well will be enhanced.
Yeah.
But it's not enhanced because you have this wrong. And so he's like, here, he give me these things of what to work on. And so I worked on those for 3-4 months. And I mean, he set me on a path that, a year later, I got into San Diego Wildstorm, which was like the top tier at the time to get into.
And that would have been, super exciting for you.
Yeah.
Professionally, you go down to San Diego.
Image like, Comics was out there, which they were the top seven that had left Marvel because of financial, you know, right. They could, bottom line is like Marvel could print everything they wanted that those artists did and they would never get a penny.
Okay.
And so there was a lot of financial tension and some creative tension. And so the top like seven artists formed their own company called Image.
Got it.
And began studios.
And you moved out to San Diego to do this.
To work in Wildstorm.
And you found San Diego a little bit more desirable than Orlando.
It was not very hot.
It's like one of the greatest.
But always sunny.
It's one of the great cities.
We lived there almost 2 years and it rained twice.
Yeah.
Twice.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was great. Yeah, I mean, we had one car. She drove it and I rode my bike.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, it was fine.
So why only 2 years?
Okay, so industry, that's comic industry.
Okay.
So the industry, I get in 96.
Yeah.
Yeah. So 96 to 97, these new image guys had created this plethora of new books that had come out because they had formed a new company. Mm-hmm. And what had happened is all the baseball card collectors from the early 90s had gotten on board to buy all of these books.
Oh, okay.
Assuming that, hey, this book is going to be like Superman number one someday. So like, I want 20 of them. Mm. But when you're printing, you know, 4 million copies, they're not valuable compared to there's, you know, 10 Superman number ones in existence that are around. Everything was thrown in the trash can from the old days. So those kind of things, there were a lot of speculators. And so they boomed the market, blew it up. And then all of a sudden, you know, it just crashed. Everybody started getting out in the mid-90s. And it part of it, I want to say, was even our fault. There was not quality writing in some of it, but really quality art. And so some of the stories weren't great. It was kind of the first glut in the market where there were just too many stories and not enough good ones. Kind of like movies, right? So that worked out well, you know, now everybody started bailing and learning 3D to go into games.
Yeah.
So like my peers, that's where they all went. You know, the guys that I worked with, Ryan Benjamin, Matt Broom, Dan Norton, they all ended up in games. So at Sony, at Blizzard, and at like Riot doing League. And so those guys, they all moved on and did that. I was friends with Matt. I was a good friend with Matt. So like I would kind of keep track of him and what should I do and what should I learn. And so when we moved back here, we still hadn't found a great church out there either. So when we moved back here, one for her because she had a business degree and we had connections here with her dad for business, and even though she didn't need them. But we came back. We knew we should get a job doing that, and I could learn what I needed to learn here, just like I had done before. And so came back. I started going to first I paid for school at a small school in Schaumburg, like an art institute. It's not even there anymore. The building's gone. But and then I went to Harper, had a continuing ed for learning CGI. And I was like, oh, this is Maya. This is sweet. This is like top grade stuff. And Matt's learning it. So I should learn it because I want to go into games then, because it was a natural progression of like, this industry's tanking. We're not making any money right now, but it parallels so smoothly. Like, what do you need to do? We need to create characters. We need to create assets, you know, from whatever, right? Yeah. Competitive web, you name it, environment. So it's all the same thing.
Yeah.
So a lot of us were going that route.
Okay.
So I trained to do all that and never did any of it. But,
you know, you love the left-hand turns in your life.
He's got a sense of humor for sure.
You've three kids.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Two girls and a boy.
Mm-hmm.
How old are your girls?
24 and 22.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then your son?
John beat us to heaven at age 9.
Age 9. He would be how old now?
Would he have just turned 11 in August?
In August.
Yeah.
That's a big gap.
Yeah. Surprise.
Surprise. Yeah.
No,
yeah.
Like, yeah.
It was.
11 years later.
Yeah.
You're like, well, hello.
Apparently when you're happily married, this is what happens.
Yeah.
You know, the Lord just decides sometimes to hand you another kid.
So you guys, I mean, seriously though, you guys were kind of going along, just you two girls.
Yeah.
This is what we got.
Yeah.
The Lord. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden you get this little guy.
Yeah. And it was a boy. I had no idea what to do with a boy. I had raised two girls. All my friends had girls. Like,
yeah.
And then all of a sudden there is this little boy.
Yeah. Which would have been an absolute delight.
He was fantastic.
Yeah. And when he was, what year was he born?
2013.
Yeah. Got it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we were actually, getting ready to move from Rolling Meadows out to towards the school in Elgin because my kids had gone here for the years that the school was open. We're not sitting here in the computer lab. Yeah. And then we decided that it was best to move to be closer to the school. He said, I'll always commute to work, but we need to live where their friends are. So we were going out there. And we thought it was going to be an 8-year move, that we were going to go out there, stay 8 years, and then come back here where our heart is and where our family is. And And instead it became an 18-year move because John. Yeah. So, yeah, that was a shock. That was a shock.
And John, was he... What did John pass away from? What was his?
It was DIPG, diffuse intrinsic pontine glioma. Which is a really big word. Our hospice nurse called it the big daddy of them all. It is terminal at diagnosis. Okay. It's a tumor in the brainstem.
And so when he was a healthy kid though, mm-hmm. for a lot of years.
Yeah, very.
Yeah, just athlete, baseball.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's every how you sport. Got into baseball.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's how I got dragged back in. I had escaped through injury and then
I know, and then all of a sudden you're being thrust back into baseball. But he got and when was he diagnosed?
He started having some weird symptoms in January of 2022, correct?
What weird symptoms?
His coordination was a little off. Uh-huh. He had
and that was dizziness. Abnormal. I mean, he was always pretty coordinated.
Super coordinated.
It was his first year playing baseball for the league because it was just post COVID.
Yeah,
where all that had been shut down, and so we got him into fall ball, and he was like he had never played before, but he was like hitting. He was second amazing. Best out of the team. You know what I mean? Except for the one kid that had like he just not had gotten into traveling.
Just had
times.
A talent for it.
Yeah, he had a knack for it, and he just so he was doing this. But I remember as we started playing more, like in December and whatnot, we had like coaches for him over at Athletes HQ, which is right across the street from Harvest, and he had done great at Athletes HQ, and then he was like in January, he was really starting to struggle in places, and it was just weird. It was like, this guy is usually your hitter. And they'd be in these groupings of four kids.
Yeah.
And like, why is he struggling? Like, it's strange. You know, like there was this and then that. Yeah. There was other things too. My first thing was the pictures at that stupid scene.
At the
game at the Bucks game.
Yeah.
A friend of ours from here had given us Bucks tickets. And so we went and it was just me and John. And so we were sitting in their season tickets and we asked the people behind us to take a picture. And so they were taking a picture, but John couldn't
smile.
He was losing the facial control. And so he couldn't smile. So it's weird, downturned. And I'm like, are you okay? You know? And he's like, yeah, I'm fine. I'm happy. You know, it's like, okay. So those things are your first precursors that are like shots across the bow, but don't want to think the worst. You're never going to think the worst.
At the time, you just were like, it's just
I'm like, okay, it's weird. Maybe it's just a weird smile thing or something else, and we'll see.
Well, and he had COVID in December. And so even the doctor at first, as we started seeing some of these symptoms, he's like, it's not uncommon for, you know, post COVID.
Sure.
To have some weird stuff.
Yeah. Like he wasn't sleeping great and, you know, some things like that. And so we kind of brushed it off for a while, set up some other tests, like a little bit in the distance, because, you know, you can't get in the doctor for a while. And then the weekend before Valentine's Day, we were seeing a ton of symptoms start to come. Like he truly could not smile out of one side of his face. He could only shut that eye partially. And I'm on the phone with the doctor and I'm like, listen, I'm seeing these things. And, you know, the mama heart, you just kind of, you're looking at your kid, you're like, something's not right. And he said, okay, if more stuff starts to come, I want you to call our office. But if you do end up having to go to the ER, I want you to go to CDH because they have a direct line into Lurie's, which at the time I kind of just tucked in and whatever. And we called him Saturday because he had started throwing up. And the nurse was like, oh, you know, those like kids don't just get one bug at a time. It's not a big deal that he's throwing up. It's fine. And we just prayed and prayed. I remember Sunday night us going to bed and Rob praying like, Lord, we need one more symptom. If you show us one more symptom, we'll take him in. Yeah. Like, we don't know what to do. We have a cardiologist appointment next week. We have all these things.
On Tuesday.
Yep. Are we being nervous or are we being, you know, wise? And sure enough, he woke us up at 4 o'clock in the morning. Mom, my head really hurts. And Rob said, okay, let's go.
Yeah.
So off we went. And by six something in the morning, we knew that he had a really nasty tumor, but we had no clue until the next day what it was.
So they did some tests on him and they found that it was a tumor at that time.
Yeah. They did a CT scan. That was it. This is one of the only cancers that is 99%. It's 99.something% diagnosable from scan alone.
Oh, wow.
So they pretty much knew at CDH what it was, but the sweet nurse and the sweet doctor actually told me not to look up anything online. She said, don't Google anything yet. This is where his tumor is. we're sending you down to Lurie's.
Yeah.
And so we did. But it was really cool. I was actually talking to some girls about this last night. Because it was COVID, nobody's allowed back into the hospitals, you know, like it was kind of on lockdown. And we had texted out as soon as they found the tumor, and we were still sitting there at CDH. And some of the nurse comes in and said, there's some men out there to see you. And it was three of our elders. And the doctor smuggled them back so that they, so we're in this tiny little room. And sweet Darren Weidman said, I have some verses, John, that I can read for you. You know, can I read you some verses? And he read a couple verses, and John said, I have a verse. And I'm thinking, oh, whatever his memory verse was from school this week that he's going to share, whatever. He whips out with Isaiah 41:10. He says, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. And I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Mm-hmm. And that was for us really, that's how he responded to the entire thing. Mm. He was level. He was content with the fact that God decides. We told him at Lurie's the next day, once they had decided what it was, we had gratefully, we had had some experience with cancer in the past. My brother passed away from cancer when he was 35, and he was a doctor. So I kind of got like, we got a lot of the backstage vision of a lot of these things. And we knew what clinical trials were, and anything that they could offer us was only stage one, where they were testing for dosage and safety. And nothing had shown any promise or any progress since this treatment, the radiation treatment that they ended up giving him, that just prolonged his life in years, decades. So there wasn't anything on the horizon that we were willing to try. My brother had tried quite a few things to no avail. And so we were very honest with John, and we said, you have a cancer tumor and the doctors can't fix it, but our trust is in the Lord. Mm. And he said, okay. And honestly, that was him all the way to the end. Yeah. I mean, we still say John taught us how to live well and how to die well, because he just set out to make the most of every opportunity.
Yeah. So like, how do you, what were the first things that went through your minds when you were, when you found out that diagnosis? It's one thing for him to do it. Sometimes I've never been had that diagnosis, but I mean, I've had chest problems and stuff, and I've often thought it's harder for my wife than it is for me, because you're sitting there and you're like, well if I go I go, you know. But for her it's like, wait, what, the possibility of not having me or whatever. How did you guys in those first moments words?
I mean, honestly, Jeff, like, it was the Lord. Like, when he says he's near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit, like, he was near. He was with us. It was heartbreaking, because you're looking at your kid who last week was running around the yard, who 2 days ago was at school, you know, and they're telling you he has a terminal diagnosis.
Right.
And they say 9 to 12 months. And you're looking at it like,
what?
This was the athlete kid. Like, I was already trying to figure out, you know, is he going to go pro for baseball or soccer? You know, like, you don't think that that's on the horizon for a 9-year-old, you know. We were at the age of worrying about aging parents and kids in college and all those things. And then, like, it's laser focus. All of a sudden you get a year max, unless the Lord stays his hand. And the Lord carried us.
For sure. And I think we knew, because we'd walked through some crazy things. You know, your dad had passed with an accident, you know, when he was 62. Mm-hmm. And so we'd walked that through with your mom. Mm-hmm. We'd seen your brother go a couple years after that, where he was a doctor, so he knew. Mm-hmm. Like, he knows the big C cancer versus the little C's, you know, and he's like, I'm not getting fixed. Yeah. You know what I mean? If one of these things I'm trying to take so that I can stay around for my kids, it might prolong me for a year or two.
Yeah.
But after that, it's coming back, and I can't do anything about it. And then my brother, his son, had neuroblastoma. And so that's typically deadly, and really until almost a year of of when Aiden got it, mm-hmm. and they were able to cure him down at Lurie's.
With a clinical trial.
So we had walked a little bit with my brother in that, in like, there you go through the thought process.
Sure.
Like, what if this were you? You know what I mean? This is your 4 or 5 year old, you know, how mm-hmm. do you deal with like the possibility that he may have to go? And so we were there, I think, gratefully, we're both wired super similar. You know, they talk a little bit about, I think, marriage dysfunction a bit after the death of a child, which makes sense, I think, when you look at how different we can react to things. Mm-hmm. But we were both really similar-minded. Very active, like, okay, so what's next? What do we do? What's our part? Let's just enjoy what we have rather mm-hmm. than let's try all these drugs and it sure. may do worse. Like, so I think we had a couple of those things we had already dealt with, mm-hmm. you know, with just your brother and your father. And mm-hmm. so it was like, okay, what do we do? Like, I remember the thing I could say, you know, while I was sitting there and they were telling me, I was like, okay, well, when can we leave? Mm-hmm. Like, when can we get out of here? I don't want to be here anymore, like in the hospital. We'd already had a horrible night trying to sleep there the first time. Mm-hmm. And they were great. They got us out
by 7 o'clock yeah. that night.
And we
spent
back
one
home.
Night in the hospital his
yeah,
whole life.
And exactly.
That was it.
So, and it was great because then it was exactly that. It was us at home,
yeah.
you know, mm-hmm. until the end. And so that was, we were grateful for that, everything. Yeah. And that was the piece of it. We talk about when we had his service, the visitation piece, it's just so many people coming through and we would just thank them for praying for us. Like we knew mm-hmm. how we were there. You know what I mean? They were more emotional than we were. You know what I mean? We'd been preparing for
yeah.
9 months or 11 months yeah. at that point.
Yeah. Yeah.
But coming to grips with it.
Yeah.
For them, you know, it was final. And again, a lot of people don't understand the difference between the big C and little C, like ones that yeah. you're going to get away of. They don't know what that means. You know, they think, oh, you know, take something and maybe be all right.
So when you guys take a step back, so it's what's interesting about me having opportunity to interview people and talk to them about like their life as a whole is that you get to see the whole, you know what I mean, from the beginning. And so I, you know, not knowing you, well at all, like I'm sitting here thinking to myself, right, so here's what the Lord gave you, a very surprised, right, out of nowhere, mm-hmm. a little boy for 9 years. Mm-hmm. So as you reflect now, I mean, you'll see him again, mm-hmm. but as you reflect now and you think, what are the things that you're most thankful for regarding that gift of 9 years?
Well, I think we knew from the beginning he was maybe days old, if that. And we were in our house in Elgin, our brand new house, because we moved out there. We moved in when I was 9 months pregnant. So, like, we're in this new house in this new area with our kids in this new crazy season. And Rob looked at me. We're standing over. I remember the little bassinet, you know, the little. Uh-huh. And he said, you know, this one's not just for us, right? Like, we felt like the girls were gifts for us. And he knew from day one that John was not for us. He was for something larger than that. Of course, we never thought, like, this was never, you know.
No.
Like I said, he's going to be a pro baseball player or a pro soccer player. Look at how great he is, you know, all the things.
He's not going to be those things.
Yeah.
We did not think that.
He
but
didn't.
We knew we would have a blast.
But, you know, but yeah.
Just walking but, past.
Yes, he was just, he was different and energetic, and he spoke to... I mean, he grew up with high school age sisters at age 3, you know, so he could talk to anybody like a friend, and he did. And so he had friends from, you know, 3-year-old to 87-year-olds, and he loved them all well. And so that's what I thought, you know, in my head, that's what I thought he meant by saying he's not just ours. Mm. He was for all of us as he was growing and being who he was.
Well, he sure has, I mean...
Who knew?
Like I showed up here in the middle of this particular trial for you guys, and I got to tell you, the impact that your son had on the lives of so many people it's hard to calculate.
It's unreal.
Yeah. So you weren't wrong.
About well, that. And the funny thing is, right? Like, we named him John, which means God is gracious, mm-hmm. and his middle name is Aaron, which means strength, and it was very fitting on both counts. But we named him after John Smith. Mm. And I remember we went and had dinner with John and Sherri the night after he died. And Rob was in tears because he said, I wanted him to be part of your legacy, John. Hmm. Like, I wanted this to But I look at it now and I look back and I think, oh my goodness, he is. Yeah. Like, what a legacy. What an amazing thing that we got to shepherd this little kiddo for 9 years. And he impacted more people in 9 years than I could have in a lifetime.
Yeah, like a comet.
Right?
I mean, just blazing through the sky.
And isn't that just like the Lord?
Yeah.
You know, like that's nothing. We were not stellar, perfect parents. We weren't. There was no magic sauce. There was no, I couldn't hand a playbook to somebody.
Yeah.
It was who John was and who his Savior was that made him who he was. And that was a phenomenal thing to have a front row seat to. Yeah. Somebody to live and to die with full assurance of the Lord's sovereignty and the Lord's love for him.
Yeah.
That was unreal.
Yeah, we were grateful. I mean, it summed up in that term.
Yeah. Yeah,
we were grateful for all of it. Yeah. I think that's been the best part about looking back on it all was just we were just always grateful. We were grateful to people praying. We were grateful for how it went. We were grateful for 9.5 amazing years.
Right.
Yeah. You know, like just joy-filled. Kidhead is like magical, you know. Like if the stupid T-shirt cannon was going off, we got a T-shirt.
Yeah.
Like, and you're like, this is kind of weird. Like just how this happens all the time. Like there's six out there, you know. Yeah. Why are we always getting one? Like just funny things like that. At sports events, but yeah, he was great. It was a fun thing. It was an interesting learning experience. But
I bet it has grief's a pain. It's terrible. It comes, it goes, it beats the living daylights out of you one day, and then it's different. Has the grieving been what you expected? Has it been?
You know, it wasn't bad. I think when it's over, there's a bit of relief with anything with cancer. I remember this with your brother. Mm-hmm. There's a little bit of like, oh, okay, suffering peace is over. And so you're grateful there. In the beginning for me, it was the memories of that were the hardest. Mm-hmm. And then it's, oh my gosh, because I consume a bit of movies. I love storytelling. And so then it becomes like death on TV.
Yeah.
Mm. It just, and death in films. Like, it's just like, it's something totally different. And it will... It goes 0 to 60, all of a sudden it gets you.
It's
like,
crazy.
I had a friend of mine who prepped me for like the new Avatar movie. He's like, by the way, there's this scene where the son dies and all of the families around him. Yeah. And I'm like, okay.
Yeah. Can I? I'm going to go to the toilet at that moment.
And I was grateful because he prepped me and I was ready for it. Yeah, it didn't mean it wasn't hard, but it was, I was ready for it. But yeah, that's it's weird because I'd watched so much of that stuff growing up. And then all of a sudden you're like, oh, can't watch, you know. Yeah. I can, but it's hard.
It just jumps on you.
So it's just weird.
You.
Yeah, it just jumps. Sure, and then it goes back. Yeah. And it's fine. And we remind ourselves over and over again. Yeah. You know, it just I mean, he taught us stuff, and that's what was great about it. And, you know, childlike faith, you know, you can talk about what that means, but I don't think you know, right? Because you have your kids, and you're growing up, and you're trying to raise them.
Yeah.
And then they become adults, and you're like, okay, cool. Like, you're figuring this thing out. You're making it your own, you know? So childlike faith, yeah, I guess it's instructional, but what really is it? And so for him, it was neat to see it, something a little bit more standard. Because we used to tell him, we're like, we don't know how many days we have, you know? And he was like, yeah, it's fine. I don't know how many days I have. And you're like, okay, cool.
Oh, all right. So, and I remember he woke up, so he started declining in November of that year. He stopped going to school. And then he passed 3 weeks into January on the 21st. And I remember, and he was just like, the decline was hard. And he woke up on Christmas Eve morning. And at that point, Rob was sleeping on the floor of our bedroom those days. And John was sleeping next to me in bed because he was losing a little bit of his talking speech. So he could tap me. But he woke up and he tapped me, said, Mom, God gave me another Christmas Eve. Like, he was just genuinely grateful for each little piece. And I think as we watched that, it made us grateful. Mm. You know, it's... He set the tone, I think, for how we walked it. Had he been a wreck, I think it would have been much harder for us. But the Lord, in his ridiculous supernatural sovereignty and kindness to us, John received it all with open hands and said, okay. And he said at multiple points during the whole thing, like when we told his tumor was growing again that October, he said, it's okay. God decides. And he went outside to play. And I remember thinking, like, Yeah. That's that faith of a child. Yeah. That's it. Yep. He is at full peace knowing his God decides.
Yeah.
And I think for the grief piece, someone asked me afterwards, like, have you grieved yet? And honestly, we did so much of our grieving during that year.
Yeah.
Like, it's a surreal thing to watch your kid playing in the yard, you know, running bases, hitting homers, and knowing that the clock is ticking.
Yep.
And so I think that was the hardest grief season, when he was okay,
yeah,
but not okay.
Yeah.
And so after he passed, I mean, and there was also, I read enough to know what the end was supposed to look like. And I was scared to death. And the Lord carried us.
Yeah.
He did it. He did it. I can't explain it. I can't, it's hard. I want to put words to give justice to what he's done for us. And I feel like I can't, because he truly carried us and met us at every point of need in those hardest hours.
Well, you guys have faced down, quite honestly, the greatest fear that most people fear more for the death of their children than they do for their own death or the death of anybody else. And you guys are living testimony to God's kindness and providential care for you. Also, you know, to live as Christ, to die as gain. Yeah. And, you know,
he's John, doing fine.
John, yes, is an embodiment of that. I was thinking the other day about how the way that we view things here is that everything cool is happening right here in this world. And, you know, up in heaven, they must be looking down at us being really interested. And I was wondering, I wonder if it's the other way around. Do you know what I mean? Like, just to be with the Lord is so enrapturing and so fantastic that they look at us and be like, man, I can't wait for you to experience this greatness.
Right. Do you remember when you shared the analogy of the taster spoon, the ice cream taster spoon?
Yeah.
John was in church that day.
Yeah.
And we talked about it afterwards and he grabbed hold of that.
Yeah.
That was something that a 8-year-old boy could understand.
Yeah, I love it. Yeah.
And that's it. He's got the whole scoop now.
I know he does. So all the hard bits are over.
Yeah.
That's right. I hope so.
Yeah, no, they are for him. It pertains to him and you. Yeah. All the hard bits are over. You already walked through the hard bits. You climbed the mountain.
Yeah.
You get to ski down it.
I think we were carried kicking and screaming up the mountain, but well, we made it.
Yeah. We thank God for you guys and for just the testimony you have about God's goodness and how it is that he's grown you both in it. And thanks so much for all you do for the community here at the church and elsewhere. I never hear words of you about you guys that are not positive and glowing. I mean, if I knew you, I would add some that aren't. Do you know what I mean?
Well, I pay our people well.
I feel like, yeah.
Yeah. Like, here you go.
Yep. Right. Anyway, friendship dues.
Exactly.
It's great to talk to you. God bless you. Thanks so much for talking to me for this time. For the rest of you, we'll talk to you next time.